Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations.
There is a new pope, and at least for a little while, everyone, Catholics, of course, but also Protestants, Jews, believers, non-believers, will speculate on the question, what will he do? For the most part, a good pope is defined as someone who does what the critic would do if he were pope. The suddenness of the election of Albino Luciani left the journalistic world, for once, speechless. On the day after it happened, I was seated between man and wife, and she confessed some disappointment at the initial allocution of the Pope. Her husband replied with some impatience, "How would you express yourself if you suddenly woke up infallible?" Although a great many people have in recent months talked about a new Pope and his likely policies, no one has aroused more attention than Malachi Martin, whose book, The Final Enclave, described a fictitious scene in which the modern Catholic Church would more or less terminate, its successor inspirited by a kind of third world Christianity, shorn of the traditional liturgies, hierarchy, and protocols. Critics did not quite know what to make of the book, but everyone notices what Malachi Martin says and writes about because of his background, his training, the force of his intellect, and his imaginative ingenuity. Mr. Martin was once Father Martin, a Jesuit priest, trained in theology at Louvain, specialist in the Dead Sea Scrolls with a doctorate in Semitic languages, archaeology, and Oriental history, close associate of Cardinal Bea and of Pope John XXIII, an Irishman who has become an American citizen, author of Three Popes and the Cardinal, Jesus Now, and other books, and religious editor for National Review. Our examiner today will be Mr. Jeff Greenfield, who will be introduced later. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Martin to comment on a few sentences he wrote in 1974 about the next pope. He said then that the next conclave would, and I quote him, be the most important and the most difficult papal election in about 400 years. Is it your impression that this turned out to be so?
Yes, Mr. Buckley, it really it was and still is that, because at that conclave, if we take conclave as including the period from the death of Paul VI, which was announced on August 6th, until late in the evening of August 25, when the actual conclave began, within those days, and then in the, I think, from Friday evening until Saturday evening, was played out, I think, a crisis which had to be decided one way or the other, and this was the conclave at which it was decided. So yes, I think it has been the most important, because I think the Catholic Church has made a decision, in its leaders of course, to go in one direction.
Well, in the same essay you wrote, quote, "The candidate ultimately chosen cannot be one who straddles the rift." Is it your impression that Pope John Paul, in fact, is not intended to straddle the rift? And if so, what side will he come to represent?
Well, I think to that question we should really, in order to answer, look to detailed points, because we can only make general statements and there really wouldn't be an answer. He will reinforce all the moral and ethical rules that Paul VI did insist upon. Concerning abortion, contraception, homosexuality, premarital sexuality, divorce, his own infallibility, the existence of the devil, married priests, the celibacy of priests. He will stand by all those, plus all the other basic dogmas and beliefs of the Catholic Church. Where he could straddle and where he won't would be where Paul VI straddled. Paul VI, as we know, took all those stances and created terrific hubbub, as you know, in the church and outside it. And yet, as in politics, Paul had a different policy. And in theology, as regards discipline, he had a different policy. He let left-wing, if we can apply the political terminology to theology, he left a theologian like Hans Küng, or Charles Curran of Catholic University, or Avery Dallas of Fordham, Gregory Baum, the two Dutchmen, Schoenberg, Skillebakes, plus John Baptist Metz, the entire Northern European theological movement and its counterpart in the States, he let it run free, rather free, in fact, very free. When Charles Curran, for instance, condemned the teaching of the Catholic Church and Paul VI's teaching in particular about contraception, there was no condemnation. So in theology, Paul straddled. As regards politics, he also straddled. When Allende, the Marxist dictator, was in Chile, Paul smiled neutrally or benignly. For Pinochet, the back of his hand. When the missionaries, white Portuguese missionaries, wanted to withdraw from the former Portuguese colony of Angola, I think it was, in protest against colonialism, Paul allowed them. Now they can't even get back there, or with difficulty. But he had a left-wing touch, and Paul was doing this deliberately from a rather cold-blooded, rational policy, because he was persuaded from the year 1967 that, come what may, we couldn't stop the advent of communist parties, legally or by violence, both in most of the main countries in Western Europe, Italy, France, Spain, Portugal, Holland, and in every country from Mexico down to Patagonia, down to the tip of Latin America. And hence his idea was, let's survive by making friends. And he pushed this policy further by straddling on the question of diplomatic relations. For instance, in Hungary, he consented to conditions for the church there, which are intolerable, really. Every bishop has literally a KGB man sitting at his chancery, and you give your card, and he computerizes that with Moscow. For 7.5 million Catholics, Paul agreed to 5 seminarians a year, one boys' school, one girls' school, and so on. Limitations beyond belief. With no right-wing government, political right-wing government, would Paul have any such truck? So he straddled the fence there. And then when his own editor in October 77, yes, last October, wrote in Paul's own paper, we must now teach our children what is good in Marxism. Well, Virgilio Levi is still the vice editor of the Osservatore Romano. So Paul straddled the fence. And incidentally, just to round off these remarks about Paul, that's why he left the church with no effective leadership, and why over 60% are confused between this very vibrant left wing, in this country rather headed by Cardinal John Dearden, and the right-wing traditionalist of Lefebvre. Now then, Paul went after Lefebvre, as they say in my native country, with a hacksaw. It's an expression to mean that he really went after him. He harassed him, he suspended him, he was brought to Rome and treated as a madman by the 3 cardinals that Paul appointed. he intervened with the Argentine government when Lefebvre went there to stop any big public meeting. So Paul sort of tried to straddle between the two, because he and Villot, the Cardinal Secretary of State, had accepted as axiomatic that they had to build bridges to the third world mentality in Latin America and in Europe. Now, Luciani, Albino Luciani, was elected. First of all, may we back up a little?
Sure.
About a conclave.
I'm enjoying this.
I may be talking too long.
Not at all.
Most Irishmen are inclined to talk too long. But in a conclave, the first thing elected is a policy. That's the first thing. And after that, then they say, well, Cardinal Buckley, please stand up. You know this policy, will you accept it? And His Eminence may say, yeah, accepto, I accept it, or non accepto, anyway, I don't want to be Pope, or I accepto juxta modum, I accept it with my own suggestions. And that's number one. Number two, they never go into conclave without having picked the candidate. In conclave, the function of conclave nowadays, since about the 75th conclave, is to assemble a consensus around the chosen candidate. And normally it's like a board of directors, where there are 4 or 5 or 6 prime movers that choose the man they know. Then they all come in from the hinterland and they say, well, it's Cardinal Poggio, it's Cardinal Buckley, it's Cardinal whatever it is, and he's the candidate and here's the policy. And that policy is based on an assessment of the church in the various parts of the world where the church is important, and on the economic and political projections for those parts of the world. Now, this time, Paul VI's death was announced on August 6th. And Wyszynski, Stefan Wyszynski, this Pole, whom the Romans have always referred to contemptuously as our Holy Father of Central Europe, he sort of steamrolls everybody, having dealt with Gomułka and Gierek, and the post and the Stalinist period in Poland. He's a strong man. He and Wojtyla Krakow and a man called Höfner, Joseph Höfner, a strong, arrogant German cardinal. I'm sure his arrogance stems from his desire for the kingdom of God, but that's his reputation. And Ratzinger, and then the four Spanish cardinals, Gonzalez, Giubani, Bueno y Monreal, and this terrific man, Vicente Enrique Tarancón of Madrid, came in and said, no way, we won't accept your candidate or the policy. And we, Wyszynski said in his very Polish German, wir werden hier bis Weihnachten warten, bis dass wir den richtigen Kardinal haben.
That sounds very hortatory.
Yes, yeah. we'll wait here even until Christmas. Mm-hmm. So then the conflict, which should have begun on the 13th, and then on the 15th or the 20th, began on the canonically latest day, the 25th. And there emerged then the new coalition headed by Benelli, Giovanni Benelli, the young cardinal of Florence, whom Paul VI made a cardinal before his death, because if Benelli hadn't been a cardinal when Paul VI died, he would now be happily or unhappily turning the handle of a Gestetner machine in a walled town in Calabria, in exile forever, because he was so unpopular. Benelli and Chappi, who is the Venerandus, who is the spiritual father to everybody in Rome, and Wyszynski of Warsaw, and the two Germans start a new coalition, and by the 20th, they had got 67, 68 votes, which is, it was 75 as the conclave majority, 2/3 plus one of 111. So they went into conclave at 5:30 on Friday, and by voice acclamation, they excluded everybody else, including the prime candidate and his policy. And then the next day, they got up with four ballotings, and it was Luciani all the way. Now, I tell that just how this conclave went to show that what made Luciani. And what made Luciani was the outlook of this new coalition. And they have a very definite view of things. They want no truck with communism. And they say what Wyszynski did in Poland, we can do all over the world. And what Wyszynski did in Poland is very interesting. In 1945, after a Nazi occupation and two Stalinist occupations, the church emerged there. They hardly had a church or a seminary or a printing press or a school or a convent. They had no money in the bank, and they hadn't got one square inch of land, and they had no diplomatic clout and no political influence. And Wyszynski told me 2.5 years ago that they made the resolution that for the first time in about 700 years, the Polish church wouldn't politic. And the result was when the workers rioted in Gdansk and Gierek rushed over to the cardinal and said, you've got to get them back to work. We need food, clothes. Gdansk is very important. Wyszynski said, yeah, da, or whatever he spoke to him. And then he got in the pulpit the following Sunday and he tongue-lashed Gierek and his communist government for their atheism and their infringement of the rights of man. He then wrote a letter to the workers and said two things. He said, you have the right to strike, but you also have the obligation to think of food and clothing for your fellow countrymen. He never exhorted them to obey the government. He never played politics. And their rule was they wouldn't play politics. They would only deal with the ethical and moral and religious content of any situation. So Benelli and the others say, why don't we do the same thing? Why must we back this government or that government? There was great criticism, I must tell you, in our presidential year when Jimmy and Jerry were running, because the question of abortion rose. And you know how difficult and torturous a question abortion is. And well, then the Catholics got very het up. We Catholics got very het up. We said, we must find out what the candidates hold about this. So look, you and I know that if any cardinal of the Holy Roman Catholic Church, and we have 10 of them in this country, or any bishop, and we have quite a lot of them, rang Jimmy or Jerry at 3 a.m. in the morning, Jimmy or Jerry would jump out of bed from their wife to answer the cardinal. I mean, that vote is so important. But they didn't do that, Mr. Buckley. They went in a limousine with the press to the quarters of the candidate. And outside the quarters, they addressed the press, telling them what they were going to do. Then they went inside, and they were closeted with the candidate. And then they came out and made another announcement. Now, that's politicking. they want to rule this out, and the Vatican wants to rule out, Luciani wants to rule it out, as well on local planes as on the international plane. And that means no truck with Mr. Belanguer, and it means no truck with the Sandinists in El Salvador, which will afflict the Jesuits an awful lot, since they trained the Marxist guerrillas in El Salvador and Nicaragua. And it'll mean a lot of trouble for the Marinol fathers and sisters, who have gone very far in their Marxism.
Does that mean we won't be canonizing Joe and Lai, as was suggested by the Bishop of Cuernavaca?
Well, Sergio Mendez Arceo, I think, is going to receive a little letter, you know. He may take early retirement, but we will pray for Joe and Lai, but the honors of sainthood, I think, Luciani will
be postponed.
Be postponed.
Until the final conclave.
Until the final conclave, that's right.
Well, do I understand you to be saying that the Wyszynski approach has in effect become the official approach,
and
yes. it is one that is absolutely intransigent in respect of the claims of Marxism over the total man?
Yes, it's absolutely intransigent. You see, Paul argued and Vio argued, and by the way, if you talk today to Cardinal John Dearden or Cardinal Silva Enriquez of Chile or one of the four French cardinals, whenever I think of those four French cardinals, I'm inclined to say what one cardinal said to Pacelli, who was then Pius XII when Hitler came to Rome, and Ribbentrop came to Rome, sorry, and Pacelli wouldn't see him, but this Maglione saw him, and he came into Pacelli after and he said, "Well, I have prayed God that he would open his eyes." And Pacelli said, "Well, please God, God will close them." So I often think about the four French cardinals. They're so left-wing, they're so feckless, and I know they're cardinals of my church, and you know how rabid a Catholic I am for authority, but still. Anyway, if you talk to them, or talk to Likoy of Hungary, or Trinh of Hanoi, you'll find them all with this mentality. Look, we're not atheists, we're not communists, but we can live with their politics and we can live with their economics. And we must, because two-thirds of humanity get to bed hungry and get up miserable. And Luciani once said, just before conclave, to somebody who was arguing like that, he said, "We haven't got to make them Marxists to cure their hunger," which of course is the basic truth. That's going to be the stress. It's no truck with Mr. Berlanguer, and no furtherance of the diplomatic relations protocols which Paul already drew up by May of this year. What it means by way of reprisals, what it means by way of change, we don't know yet, because even within the Catholic Church over here, I suppose of the 49 million Catholics in this country, 10 million are unchurched. They don't go to mass or meeting. But of the other 39 million, the most active part on the parish level and the diocesan level and the national level are leftists in theology and in politics. They're only about 2 to 3 million if you want to put a figure on it, but they're the most active part. Mm-hmm. And in theology, you have this entire group of people who have successfully attacked basic doctrines like the resurrection of Jesus, in which Hans Kuhn doesn't believe any longer, or the mysteries about the Virgin, in which apparently every Dallas doesn't believe any longer, and moral imperatives in which Charles Kern doesn't believe any longer, and so on down the line. And both Fordham and other seminaries around the country, they teach the theology of liberation, which is really Marxist Christianity, if there's such a thing. So there's going to be trouble. But Luciani himself is hewing to that line.
Now, what kind of intellectual resources does the present Pope either have himself or has available to him?
Intellectual resources he really hasn't got himself. He's not really a mental eagle. Mm-hmm. As we used to say long ago in Oxford, an intellectual greyhound. That he's not. He's practically monoglot. By the way, like practically all great men I've ever known, he speaks a little bit of bad German, bitte und danke und wo wohnen Sie, and he speaks some very Italianate French. His English is very poverty-stricken. He speaks good Northern Italian and most mellifluous Latin.
That's not bad for a monoglot.
No, it's not bad, actually, but he's been speaking since he was about 12 years old, since he entered early. His theology is strictly traditionalist. And He has read a lot of modern psychology because he abhors the use of psychology as a substitute for religion. And I remember once when he was in his homily, he made one crack about those who would interpret the Bible. He said that Peter knew that Jesus was God, not from any psychological trait. You know, I heard a bishop about 3 Sundays ago preaching and saying that grace comes out of our subconscious. You know. Freud must really turn happily in his grave at that moment. You know. But I suppose that's to be classed with Sergio Mendes Arceo and the canonization of Joan Lye. But
he has access to, at his disposal, to people who are raring to go.
Yes, at his disposal.
Who taught them?
They have all been trained in the past. They're all men of about 55. They're all men of the caliber of Benelli. They're all men who have been literally kept in their kennels by Paul and Vio. And the team they installed.
They haven't had a fling since Humani Generis?
That's right. They haven't had a fling since Humani Generis. Mm. And they have been muffled. In addition to that, there's this one more thing, which is so important, over intellect and everything else. In fact, it makes intellect possible. You know, there is a thing, we both know it, and we all know it. There is such a thing as, it's very hard to put a word in it because we've overworked several words. But it's effulgence, it's a certain comeliness, not Hollywood comeliness, but a certain power within certain people. When they come into a room or arrive, we know there's somebody here. When they go, it goes with them. And it's always in the person we love. But in certain cases, like John the 23rd or Solzhenitsyn or Mother Teresa of Calcutta, it's something they wear for everybody. And it's spirit.
And he has it.
It's an intangible but not an abstraction. And he has this power of enveloping you. And as the Chinese say, when you talk with him verbally, there's always this inner chatter going on, which means that he's communicating with you. There's an avenue open upstairs. And he looks very simple, he smiles. He's not a very beautiful man, by the way. In fact, by Italian standards, he'd be ugly. But he has this quick smile. And nobody should mistake the velvet glove. Luciani is known in his own diocese as ruthless when it comes to cutting off the rotten branch. And we should have no honeyed words about that. He's ready to cut them off. So that's his chief power. And can he pull it off? Well, as a Catholic, he can. A, if Jesus wants it like that, if that's what Jesus wants for his church right now. If he wants a leader who can exercise that power over people. And number two, if Luciani's will adheres closely enough, he will do what the Lord finally wants. But I've always thought in a man's life, there's a measure between what God wills to happen and what God is willing would happen. I don't know how Molina or Banez would put that back in the 16th century. But I think that's the case with Luciani. And there's also a case of what poor Paul VI said a year before he died, that the smoke of Satan has entered this church. We have corruption. We have cardinals who are Freemasons. Not that all Freemasons are bad. I have a whole list of Scottish uncles, Covenanters, who are all Freemasons and wear their little aprons with hammers and everything else. But it's a social club. I'm speaking about something more sinister than that. A lot of people have sold out. There are amongst the cardinals those who don't believe much. And one-third of the clergy in Spain and Italy belong to Marxist organizations. Competent sociologists assure me that two-thirds of the clergy in Latin America do so. We know several bishops who do. And we have a big, big problem.
Well, aren't there men of manifest goodwill and of a certain intellect who believe that just as Christ baptized paganism, so Christianity can baptize Marxism. You and I believe it's ontologically impossible.
That's
but
right.
if one were to take Marxism and remove from it that which most significantly characterizes it, you would have a kind of a dissipated concern for the working people and so
that's
on.
Right.
That could be used in highly adulterated
form.
That's true. You run into the problem that Chesterton identified when he said that do not go about as a demagogue asking a triangle to break out of the prison of its three sides.
That's right.
Otherwise, its life will come to a lamentable end, and Marxism, of course, will come. But of course, Marxism has come to a lamentable end in the Soviet Union.
It has, of course.
So why is it that the term Marxism is popular among Catholic clergy in Latin America, except insofar as it suggests an alternative social order that they see as malfunctioning?
That's right. Not only malfunctioning, but utterly corrupt, really, to put them. And they have a problem, and it is the present Pope's big problem, because if we face the facts, as he does now in these days, because he's getting everything put in front of him, the fact is that there is no sign at all in Western Europe or in America, North America, in America, there is no sign of a solution to the misery of millions. No real sign. In fact, if we were frank, we would say we have neither the time, it's too late, or the money, we're very poor today, or the will. The effort it would require. Now, the Church itself, the Vatican, and one must respect confidentiality in this matter, I suppose, conservatively speaking, the Vatican has a portfolio investment of about $32 billion. Its collateral is over $1 trillion. It has certainly the biggest real estate operation. There's no doubt about that. International real estate operation. And it has a huge intelligence operation. If you want to know, literally, the gypsum production in Upper Silesia, if they produce it there, the Vatican knew it on August 25. It has a tremendous power, and its prestige is huge. It has 93 of its own ambassadors out there in 93 countries. It has ambassadors from over 101. It has huge power. Now, it's embedded in the West. Western democracy, Western capitalism. What is Luciani to do? What's Giampaolo, as the Italians call him, to do? Is he to impoverish the church and distribute it all? It has been calculated that if you did that this year on January 1, next year it would be just as bad. It wouldn't relieve the misery. Therefore, is he to pull it right up and turn around and go the third world way and say we reject the West, as Paul VI was doing? And we will allow Catholics to vote the communist vote at the polls and give them that edge they need in France and the edge they need in Italy and in Spain and Portugal and Mexico and the other countries. What is he to do? Every pope since Leo XIII, and by the way, he was the first man to call for a living wage, people forget that, you know, has spoken about this, said the haves are diminishing, the have-nots are increasing, and it is the seedbed of communism. You must do something about it. So they have spoken and spoken and spoken. Nothing has happened. It's only got worse. Now, so Giampaolo has to do something on the international plane, and it must be something new, and it must galvanize. Because I'm a Westerner, as you know, and I'm a European, I'm an American. Every part of me comes from the West. And yet I know there's nothing new in the West. Perhaps in dance in America there is. Even there, one could doubt. But there's nothing new in technology except the technology to kill. We have nothing new coming out.
What's new in the West is the virtual disappearance of poverty.
Yes, that's right.
It's an extremely important datum.
It is. But it's not going to help us as regards the third world.
It is if we can export the techniques and the ethos.
Do you think we can?
Well, certainly not by encouraging the economic heresy of Marxism.
That's right. So what is he to do? Giampaolo has this difficulty. Can he take up Benelli and Wyszynski, say, we must turn it back towards Europe again? This is the heartland. Start here and build out to the world outside and form a new ethos. That's his biggest problem. And that's, I think, the problem of Catholics today. We also have this problem. As Catholics, I think, at least I have, and I think any thinking Catholic has, and the men around Luciani has this problem. Look, most practicing Episcopalians I know are willing to say, all right, this is the body and blood of Jesus. I don't understand it, neither do you. And surely, yes, the Pope in Rome has an importance beyond all other bishops. We could cavil about what orders he gives, etc. And in the Greek Orthodox, it's the same. The Greek Orthodox Church is the same thing. There's a tremendous amount of welling goodwill out there. In fact, they feel excluded by it. What are we going to do about that? Because ecumenism has gone down the road of the World Council of Churches with Mr. Potter buying arms for the Marxist rebels in Angola and Rhodesia. It has nothing to do with religion at all. What are we to do about that? Can Gianpaolo again illumine something and light them up, like Paul John the 23rd did, and then died too fast for human calculation anyway? Or are we going to, I don't know, it depends on him. Do you know of any institution today with the wealth and the prestige and the possible sources of spirit that could galvanize something, really?
Well, you ask an extremely interesting question. In order to galvanize the spirit, is it necessary to make huge and revolutionary economic strides? You speak as though it were.
Well, otherwise, what are we if we don't, what's going to happen in Latin America, where they are hungry and where their lifespan is 45, 50, and where they have no hope for a better future at all? They really haven't. In Brazil, Peru, Chile, Argentina, Bolivia, Colombia.
Well, I know what some people would say right away. You begin by doing is controlling the population.
That comes up against another difficulty, the classical difficulty of humanae vitae and the contraceptive.
Yes.
And John Paul is going to stand firm on traditional Catholic teaching there. And he will say essentially what the Third World said. I think it was at Belgrade, they had that conference on hunger, wasn't it? Where they said, no, you're trying to kill us off with your limitation of population. Mm-hmm. You're greedy, give us some of your money, give us some of your know-how. Mm-hmm. But if we don't make those huge economic strides, can you see Latin America holding together under anything but a series of strong-arm dictators whom we'd have to back?
Well, they are anyway.
That's right. How long will it hold?
Well, there are two parliamentary democracies in Latin America, in South America, and it is by no means predictable that they will continue to be democracies, and at least one of them is totally corrupt. Mm-hmm. I ask the question: is the papacy of the incumbent going to be judged by his success or lack of it in announcing, I use your terminology, something that's brand new, which will bring in its train a significant relief from the kind of poverty that oppresses them? I don't think such a thing exists to begin with.
I don't think so.
Unless you're going to bring in the loaves and the fishes, I don't think it actually exists.
I don't think it exists.
Except through capital things like capital formation, which are not new.
Which have extirpated
or all but extirpated poverty in the West.
That's right. I don't think it's John Paul's function to, again, play economics and play the necessary politics that goes with such economic activity. I think it's a long, long time since the world has known spirit moving on the religious plane and the ethical plane and affecting those who are working in politics and economics. And I think that's the demand being made on him, that he give new inspiration to it. I think we haven't seen it for a long time.
Is new inspiration an ethos or is it a perspective?
It's a perspective, but it's also this intangible force of personality, not as his individual personality, but this office, that he can have that effect of this intangible thing called spirit. It sounds fuzzy, but it's real. A leader who can have that power of spirit. I don't think Paul VI did that. I think he was an inner-directed man, very affectionate and of unswerving loyalty and automatic compassion. But he had no power to radiate. He couldn't radiate the certainty of his own faith to the crowd, nor inspire those that came to him, or start movements that were based on that. I think John Paul is supposed to do that. Otherwise, I think his papacy, otherwise a success, would be a failure, according to those who elected him.
What pope of recent history had those powers?
John the 23rd had. He could galvanize people who didn't share his faith, but did share his humanity, and who were touched by his compassion, and were touched by this man's spirit. John was untutored, and he died before he had even started, really. He started in 1962, and he died in June 1, 1963. In that short time, he started something new. He opened people's eyes, and he attracted attention. He could start them doing something. After that, it was taken over and molded by Paul VI and his administration in a very rationalized and politicized way. I think it's a long time, Mr. Buckley, since we saw somebody acting like that, a leader, really moving people's spirit. Because I say it as a believer, there is this powerful thing called spirit, which the only thing which the Russians fear, really, because they know that they can't kill it. And if that can be once communicated, and the Pope today, Luciani or John, is fighting against the middle-level bureaucracy of the Vatican, which has as his law self-perpetuation, and he's got to take all that and cleanse it and vivify it, and then he's got to start something through his cardinals and bishops. And that's spirit. Now, the will of the conclave was that. That was his mandate. And presumably, that is the will of the Lord Jesus, communicated to them in the normal way, not by tapping their shoulder or by dreams, but by the way that the Lord directs these men, whom finally he brings to the brink of authority, with nothing above them but the good God himself, to choose a pope. So I presume that is the success or failure of John Paul will be on that. He will forbid contraception and divorce and abortion, but I don't think those are main issues.
Well, it's interesting that when you cataloged the list of dogmatical reaffirmations that you anticipate, yes, so many of them touched on sex.
Well, because, yes, why?
Why, and B, is this really so desirable an emphasis?
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's that opens a big perspective. And first of all, the reason that I reaffirmed them was that practically everybody who has commented prior to the election and then after his election on Luciani, the comment was always directed to those, mm-hmm, on those issues. Mm-hmm. And basically, what I think happened is this, that Paul VI, in his drive, Paul drove very hard at his doctrine, I think, and he drove very hard in his papal policy. I think he touched on some human twist in this cosmos, because all the forces that came against him, all the things he wrestled with, belong to sexuality, belong to genetics, abortion, contraception, divorce, and to basic things like priesthood and femininity versus masculinity, the male versus the female, were basic things. And there was no sex part of it in a Hollywood sense of the word. It was really the basic forces. And he had to reaffirm the devil again, the existence of a personal it, the devil, and his own infallibility. So I think it is the nature of the age that pushed these things up. Now, personally, I think that any good pastor would realign his values and say, these are not the important things. They're important, but they're not the important things. The important thing is love and compassion and wisdom and understanding and unity and a lack of vengeance.
Charity.
I think his message, his first quiet private message to Lefebvre was marvelous. We all belong to the same house, let's talk. And apparently to one of the bickering Germans, so he has already said, look, stop the bickering. You have wisdom and we want it, but don't endeavor to drive a hole in my wall.
You took my Giampaolo.
Yeah, Giampaolo said this to one of the German progressives. Mm-hmm. So I think he'll try and quieten them all and say, shh, we have something else facing us all, which is far worse than anything you people fear. So I agree with you. The emphasis is wrong on those things, but that's the way it hit Paul. He was caught in that vortex.
Is it your opinion that a part of the covenant that you began by describing between the Pope and those who elected him pope, was the reaffirmation of Humana Vitae, or yes. Are you simply relying on his having expressed his loyalty to it?
It's part of his mandate that he would reaffirm that Humana Vitae, and everything Paul did reaffirm along that line. When Paul had set up a commission to study contraception, as you know, there was a majority report which recommended not abolishing the rule against contraception.
A relaxation of it,
yes, and a mitigation of further search in this matter. And at that time, Cardinal Sunens, who later has been acting very naughtily, if I could say that with great respect, he's been very naughty about things, Cardinal Sunens of Belgium. He ordained me, actually, so I know him very well. But they did say, look, abortion and contraception are going to fade out as problems, because the time will come when you'll have to get permission to be conceived. And even when you have permission to be conceived, your father and mother would have to do something special in order to conceive, whereas now you've got to do something special in order not to conceive. It's a different technological approach to it. But he didn't come out and say we should permit contraception. It's been reported in the paper. He never said that. He spoke for some mitigation and further examination of what conception meant.
You're talking about during the days before Humana Vitae.
That's right, mm-hmm. Before Paul mm-hmm. made his own decision. Mm-hmm. As he did it as part of his mandate. He's supposed to reaffirm all those things. And reaffirm what Paul did, but stop straddling the fence that Paul straddled. So that's part of his mandate. But I think he's going to get off that. He's not going to remain on that. And nobody's going to be condemned because they infringe those things.
Well, what about the manifest desire on the part of so many Catholics, many of them are informed, mm-hmm. for a reinterpretation of Humana Vitae as indispensable not only to re-securing the loyalty of many Catholics who now consider themselves in a perpetual state of sin. But also as an alternative to the abortions to which people are, we know from the statistics, turning uh-huh. in the absence of it. Is this going to be a felt pressure, or is it res judicata and that's it?
It's res judicata. It's not going to be a felt pressure. Look, the doctrine of the Catholic Church is going to stay. It's a hard doctrine. It's a very difficult doctrine. But it does go against one or two impulses we all take for granted today, that I have a right to sexual pleasure without any responsibility. It's taken for granted today. So why interfere with me with your laws, with your contraceptive laws? And it's taken for granted that a woman has a right to her body, which nobody denies, but she hasn't got the right to the body of a baby, or as they call it, a fetus, which is a more impersonal way of speaking about the baby you're going to cut out. But the law is very hard. The law of Christianity and the law of Jesus, which says that you don't need sexual pleasure by itself. You don't need it. And if circumstances are such that you can't have it without committing sin, then you can't have it. Just as I cannot have a Cadillac without stealing the money, because I couldn't afford a Cadillac, without stealing the money for it. You just can't have it. And as one of the few things I've admired that President Carter said, life is sometimes very unfair. One would wish for other drops of wisdom from that source, but and I say that with
that about does it.
That's about well, God help us and save us. But it's a very hard law.
You understand Christian doctrine to say that you can't eat unless there is nourishment?
Well, you know, nobody's really going to cavil over an extra anchovy. I don't like the things myself. Or that third drink, which I don't need. If that third drink, though, did push my cirrhosis, or make me strike my wife, or make my judgment go awry so I can't drive, yes, Christianity says stop drinking. It does.
Well, it defines a thing called gluttony.
Yeah.
Gluttony, I should think, in sex would be something on the order of satyriasis.
Yes.
But somewhere between abstinence and satyriasis is really the philosophical question, isn't it?
That's right. It's a very difficult. I've always felt And I think the church feels, at least I have always felt with the general tradition in the church, that nowadays we have isolated sexuality from love. Very few of us are incapable of love, really loving another human being fully. But we all feel capable of sexuality, or sex, as we call it. And we have instilled in us from everything around us that we have a right to this. The church says, no, you haven't got a right to it in that sense that you must be able to break the law in order to have it. You have a right to it if everything is right. And outside that, no, you haven't. It's a hard law. And I was talking with a friend of mine, a lady who was an Episcopalian. She's quite advanced in years. She's over 85. But she was telling me, look, when I saw all those cardinals, all those men, those hoary old men, and not one woman amongst them, I felt excluded. Why doesn't your church have a female cardinal? And I had to say to her, look, it's a hard doctrine. It's a hard doctrine, but that it doesn't. It's not born of human wisdom. And there is a craze today, there is a persuasion today that everything must be democratic and that women must be able to do everything with men, the same as men, must be equal to men, although it beats me why any woman would want to be equal to a man, I being a man. They being far stronger and being of eternity. Whereas we touch on human things and we make them, we men. But the doctrine is very hard, and Luciani and his church will keep on saying that, not emphasizing it, but they're going to keep on saying it. The world will not accept it, and as you know, we're diminishing in our effective numbers, and we'll go on diminishing. And we're in autumn, at the head of a very long winter, but...
Who knows?
Who knows?
Mr. Jeff Greenfield is a freelance journalist and author. Mr. Greenfield.
Thank you. I want to get as clear as I can and you can as to what this mission that you were describing, this challenge to the new Pope, is in the specific area of human suffering and misery. It seemed for a moment as though Mr. Buckley were going to suggest that Luciani join up with the Chamber of Commerce and bring, you know, relief smaller capital gains taxes to the third world.
I think that would improve things.
I'm sure you do. What you seem to be saying is something different. At one point, you are very highly critical of those members of the church who truck with the communists and the Marxists.
Sure.
On the other hand, it seems to me that you would disagree with Mr. Buckley when he wrote recently that he did not want the church swinging toward a kind of redistributive philosophy as a substitute for spiritualism. It seems to me you are saying that absent communism and Marxism tinging what the church does, you do think that its principal earthly mission in the years ahead is, if not redistributive, then to somehow address itself to the question of earthly human suffering. Poverty, degradation, misery.
Yes.
Am I reading you this correctly?
It's doing fine, and probably I have left confusion. Let me clear it up. I think the basic difficulty in expressing this is the difficulty I've expressed to Mr. Buckley, that we, I think, in our generation, and we older people and you younger people, none of us, I think, in our generation, or rarely anyway, have we seen men of spirit acting in public life.
Okay.
And I say that about my church, as about every church and every temple I know, and most religions I know, but confine yourself to Christianity. Now, it's not that John Paul I would get his experts to draw up a list of propositions that would be, in fact, be redistributive in nature, affecting the economy and finance and industry and trade. No, it's a far more subtle thing because it's of spirit. He must in some way affect the men who have the power to do something about the misery of millions.
But excuse me, but doesn't it come down to the same thing? And this is where I'm puzzled. Mm-hmm. I can understand your notion of your attitude toward those members of the church who are actively supporting Marxists or communist insurrectionaries. On the other hand, if one looks at a Nicaraguan situation where a single family owns, I don't know what the Somoza family owns, but it's a rather small fraction, and therefore large. Two-thirds?
A third
of the total wealth.
Exercise some moderation.
Gives a lot to charity, and he's great with kids. But if, in fact, the consequence of that regime is that a great many people go hungry
and
or in misery, then whatever the, however you define the mission of the Pope, what it comes down to is either a series of platitudes, seems to me, either a series of homilies without practical impact, or a condition in which there will be a redistributive philosophy at work, specifically in a nation such as Nicaragua.
Well,
you see what I'm trying to bridge.
I see it all right, and it's very difficult to put it into words. What he must not do is speak economics, or any bishop, or any priest. Sometimes, but for their calling cards and their collars, you wouldn't know whether it was a priest or an economist.
May he speak to the proposition that no person ought to go without bread and clothing?
That's right. More than that, yes.
Well,
but he doesn't start applying that by speaking about the government. He doesn't start fixing a living wage. He doesn't criticize existing, by name, existing agencies, call them by name. No, he mustn't play politics.
Right.
What they must do, what he and his bishops and priests must do, is so act upon spirit that the people go out, the ordinary lay people go out and do that.
Right. Now, can he speak by name to the issue of communism?
Certainly.
Okay, because it is a philosophy that, in your view, denies the place of the spirit. Well, if he sees a nation which, though not communistic, has a social structure which denies these basic spiritual impulses, why is he denied? Why ought he not to speak to that specifically?
Well, you see, it's one thing to have an organized ideology which is professedly setting out to extirpate religion, professedly. That is its profession. That's one thing. It's another thing to have a government or an administration which is full of very sinful men. Attack their sins by name, their sins. But don't start talking about their political structure, because their political structure in itself is not evil, is not anti-God, is not ideologically slanted directly against you. And you can do a lot of damage to them, to their consciences, in the good sense of the word damage, if you do that effectively. But the church hasn't done that.
Mm-hmm. Just to pursue this one step further, because as an outsider, it's sometimes difficult to get to get the handle on how the logic progresses.
Mm.
But if, in fact, and as Mr. Buckley likes to instruct me, one does not quarrel with an assumption, if, in fact, one concludes that the only way to bring about this spiritual regeneration, which includes an attack on earthly suffering, is to dismantle that particular social system, then is there not a moral imperative to speak to that as strongly as there would be to speak to a kind of ideology such as communism, which is in your view, anti-God?
If I meet a cleric, a priest, or a bishop, and I've met them, by the way, and only one cardinal, but there are many cardinals, who not only have come to the conclusion that they should dismantle, say, Nicaragua or Chile or the Argentine, but who actually have training guerrillas to do so by what they call justifiable counter-violence, I know he's acting outside his priestly mandate.
Well, one wasn't speaking to that, but there are some who believe that, for instance, nonviolent resistance is a profoundly spiritual movement, or at least can be under the right circumstances, no?
There are, yes, so much of this nonviolent resistance becomes so violent.
But sometimes it
Gandhi was followed by millions of bodies, you know. He really was.
And Martin Luther King wasn't.
That's something else. I think it turned out to be quite violent. It's awfully hard to have nonviolent resistance without some violence.
Yeah, I think that was a remarkable. Well, okay.
It was a remarkable achievement. Yeah. I'm not running that down.
And it dismantled a whole social structure of sorts, or at least helped.
Yeah, well, to make that judgment, to dismantle a social structure which is not anti-God, anti-religion, to make that judgment, we must dismantle it. I don't think that's the function of any.
Can I ask Mr. Buckley a question? I'm shifting ground here, and it has to do with the use of the whole question of the vernacular and the abolition of Latin in the Mass, because I want to, and Mr. Martin, also this is to you, but I'd like to start with Mr. Buckley. Is it the fact, do you think part of the reason why it was a mistake, let's say, is that the very fact that one is dealing in a language that one is unfamiliar with helps add a sense of majesty and mystery to the proceedings? In other words, in the way that, for instance, an Orthodox Jewish ceremony, which is done wholly in Hebrew, sounds to this apostate Jew much more solemn than a Reformed Jewish ceremony, which sometimes sounds like a country club gathering. Is that the mechanism? Is that what's at work there, do you think?
I think it's partly at work, yes. I think that the use of the word mystery applied to religion has an affinity for other forms that are mysterious. I don't believe that things ought to be intentionally inscrutable. Mm. It would be preposterous, for instance, to have a language used in a liturgy, the meaning of which was not communicated. And that, of course, never happened in the church. But the notion that the vernacular would actually increase the fervor of the participation strikes me as one of those sociological assumptions that turned out not to be proved.
Mm-hmm. But was that the basis of your objection?
That was a basis. The other was what I thought to be the hubristic approach to tradition, which I thought was defied by the massiveness with which that change was brought about.
I know.
And the impatience with any dissent whatever, and unless it came in the form of 14-year-olds creating disharmonies on banjos.
That's right. And by the way, let's also add in that Paul VI and his administration, in abolishing the Latin, violated a decree of the council, yes, on the 8th of December, 1965, forbidding Latin to be abolished. Mm-hmm. That's serious.
Now, what?
That's very serious on Paul's part.
What do you think was behind that? This is something different, it seems to me,
from his 30 seconds.
From his third world accommodation. Why do you think that particular issue was so, firmly struck by Paul?
Well, one of his motives, there were various motives we haven't got the time in 20 seconds to cover, one of his motives was that Paul was convinced the church was going to break up into localities. And the only way to really assure its continuity would be that if each locality was more or less able to carry on in its own language.
Thank you very much, Dr. Malachi Martin, author of The Final Conclave. Mr. Jeff Greenfield, ladies and gentlemen.
Printed bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding was provided by this station and by other public television stations.